jihad, put it in a pocket and close the door. And they are afraid of discussing this. And there's no shame in speaking about jihad. There are rulings and guidelines and things that need to be followed when we speak about jihad. But it is part of Islam. Fighting for the cause of Allah is something that Allah Azza wa Jal had ordained upon this nation in order for the truth to be protected upon earth. Otherwise they will wipe us off the face of the planet, which they're working very hard on doing. So we have been given the right to fight for the sake of Allah. It doesn't mean you go put some bombs around your belt, around your waist, and you kill yourself in the marketplace while people are buying some vegetables. That is not what jihad is. Rather, jihad is when the Muslims and the non-Muslims are both understanding that there's going to be a battle between us. Tayyib, they want to take over your land because they're hungry for the world. And you want to keep the religion of Allah safe and sound and protect your wives and your children. So you are fighting for the name of Allah, for Kalimatullah litakun al-ulya, for the word of Allah to be the uppermost, for Islam to remain upon earth, and they're fighting for some worldly gain. They are fighting for some worldly gain, which is under the disguise of the shaitan. Because they're fighting for the shaitan, whether in the name of Christianity, as they're doing today. See, they have no problem. And the crusaders had no problem doing what they're doing. And they don't discuss this. And they don't say, oh, you know, terrorism. No, no, no. Terrorism is only with Muslims. It is a term that is only associated with Muslims. When somebody else does it, no problem. Freedom fighter. Huh? Peace seeker. Malish, even if you drop a bomb like Hiroshima in a whole country and you kill people in thousands and leave no one on earth and ruin the land, no problem. Because they're freedom fighters. But you Muslim come and do something much less, you're a terrorist. And your Islam, your religion propagates killing the people and terrorism in the whole nine yards. Malish, we need to reach a point to understand that this is all media. Somebody's behind the media trying to poison the people and brainwash them in this sense. Don't believe the hype. And don't tell the non-Muslims that there's no jihad in Islam. Because you'll be changing the religion of Allah. Rather say that there is jihad, but you don't understand about it. And before you go there, know your Lord first. And do as Yusuf did with his companions of the prison. When they told him, interpret the dream for us, he did not interpret the dream. He gave him da'wah. He said, who is better? I have left the nation of people who have associated upon us with Allah. And they disbelieve in the hereafter. And I followed the religion of my forefathers. And it is not for us to associate any partners with Allah. And this is the bounty of Allah upon His creation. But the most of the people don't know. All companions of the prison. Is the one God, is of many gods better, or Allah, the one, the irresistible? He first gave him da'wah to tawheed. Then he interpreted the dreams. This is an asl in da'wah. Somebody come tell you, why can I marry four women? How come Muslim can do this? Why the Muslim woman is covered? Why is it? Say, look, I will explain. But first I need to tell you why. If you don't know who Allah is, Allah may never give you the understanding. Because you don't deserve to understand anything. Because you're rejecting. You're rejecting Allah Azza wa Jal. And light and guidance and understanding is a gift given by Allah to the believers. And the disbelievers are deprived of it. They may understand how to work a cell phone, but they don't understand things that have been revealed. You understand what I'm saying? It's a gift from Allah. And only the believers have that. That's why before Islam, maybe you had some misconceptions about, for example, the men having four wives. But after you entered into Islam and you studied, now your heart is okay with it. And it's the same information before and after. But now, before you were a Muslim, you were in darkness. And you didn't know Allah. After you entered into Islam and you sensed the truth and the guidance, then Allah will give you the understanding. So this is the same subject matter. So the Shaykh was mentioning that the Prophet ﷺ, Allah has given him strength on earth. And everybody was, the Romans and the Persians, they had empires. And they were, they had been fighting against each other for so many years. And no one was able to totally, eliminate the other party. Rather, they kept going until Islam came. Ma'a salama. No one remained. Although they were much more in numbers. Because Allah Azza wa Jal was given this religion, its strength, its foundation upon earth. Because people need the truth. People need guidance. People need the teachings. If there's no one and there's no strength, the truth needs strength. The truth needs strength in order to be established. This is why if you work in a company, and you're a manager, and you have the truth with you, and you present it to the people, versus a regular employee, the chances are they will accept it from you, although you bring in the same information, much more than they would accept it from the other person who is not in the same position as you. Why? Because you're the manager. Oh, the manager said, you know, turn off the refrigerator. But if a regular employee said, "Mister, who cares what this guy thinks? Man, keep this refrigerator on. We need cold water." But when the manager said, it may be the truth. The reason why the manager said this is because there's a problem with the electricity. This is the truth. Because it came from the manager, people will accept. And when it doesn't come from the manager, people may refuse. Although they're saying the truth. So what I'm saying here, the truth needs to be supported by strength. There has to be someone who supports the strength. And this is what Allah Azza wa Jalla has given this to His Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is all an indication that he is truthful. And that his religion is not innovated. Had it been an innovation, and the Shaykh will say, وَأَنَّ دِينَهُ حَقٌّ لِأَنَّ كُلَّ مَنْ افْتَرَى عَلَى اللَّهِ كَذِبًا فَمَآلَهُ الْخِذْلَانُ وَالزَّوَالُ وَالْعَدَمُ. Because whomever lies against Allah, his outcome shall be extinct. He'll be gone. He will be humiliated. He will be disappointed, and he will not be mentioned anymore. Whomever lies against Allah. وَانْظُرْ إِلَى الَّذِينَ دَعُوا النُّبُوَّةَ مَاذَا كَانَ مَآلَهُمْ النَّسُوا وَأُهْلِكُوا كَمُسَيْلَمَ الْكَذَّابُ وَالْأَسْوَدِ الْعِنْسِي. He says, and just look at those who have claimed prophethood. You know those who claim prophethood after Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Where are they? They were forgotten. He said they were forgotten, like Musaylamah al-Kadhab. This is one of them. And al-Aswad, also another person who claimed prophethood. وَغَيْرُهُمَا مِمَّنِ ادَّعَ النُّبُوَّةِ كُلَّهُمْ تَلَاشَوْا وَبَانَ بُطْلَانِ قَوْلِهِمْ. All of them are gone. And falsehood in the statement has become evident. That's why nobody, they don't have no book. They don't have no nothing. They don't have no followers. They don't have no nothing. Eventually they're going to go away. Why? Because they're not upon the truth. وَحُرِمُ الصَّوَابُ وَالسَّدَادِ. لكن هذا النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم على العكس. دعوته إلى الآن والحمد لله باقية. ونسأل الله أن يثبتنا وإياكم عليها. دعوته إلى الآن باقية وإلى أن تقوم الساعة ثابتة راسخة يستباح بدعوته إلى اليوم دماء من نوأها من الكفار وأموالهم وتسبى نساؤهم وذريتهم. هذه شهادة فعلية ما أخذه الله ولا فضحه ولا كذبه ولهذا جاءت بعد قوله ليظهره على الدين كله. He says, on the other hand, the message of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is exactly the opposite. His da'wah remains up until today, and all praise is due to Allah. And the Shaykh said, ask Allah to keep me and you firm upon it. And that we, and his, so his da'wah is until today, here. And it will remain until the Day of Judgment, firm and strong. And through this da'wah, he mentioned that those who will try to oppose the Muslims, those who will try to kill the Muslims, those who will try to eliminate the Muslims, because of this da'wah that Allah Azza wa Jalla has given the Muslims, those of the disbelievers, their wealth and their children, what have you, will be taken away from them. And they will be deprived of them in return for what they're doing against the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he said, this is a true shahada. This is a testimony from Allah. Because there's a testimony of the statement that you say with your mouth, and there's something that you testify, you see, established on earth. This testimony from Allah Azza wa Jal has been proven. We are currently living it. Otherwise, when the Muslims were only a few in numbers, they could have been killed, all of them, including the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And how many times did they try to assassinate him? Yet Allah protected him all these years. And the scholars say, look, this is the biggest evidence that this is the truth. Can you imagine a person lying against Allah? Just as we assume, to in order to deal with the disbelievers. Assuming that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam lied against Allah for 23 years, and Allah leaves a person, allows a person to lie against him and claim that he's received revelation from him and claims that he's reciting the book that has the words of Allah. And he goes and he fights the people and he does everything he does, and all this has been established, and he's a liar, and Allah wouldn't take revenge, Allah wouldn't clarify the truth to the people, will leave him misguided. Impossible. It's impossible. When they change the religion of Jesus, Allah revealed the truth again. And when they change the religion of Moses, Allah revealed. So it was back again. And every time they change the revelation that came from Allah, Allah will send a messenger in order to clarify to the people and to guide them back to the truth. This is the sunnah, the way of Allah Azza wa Jal, from the beginning of creation. So how could it be that this man will come and he will claim all these claims and speak on behalf of Allah and do these things in the name of Allah? Yet while he's lying and Allah does not do anything to him, he allows him. Rather, not only that, he supports him, he aids him, he answers his supplications, and he gives him everything that he wanted. This is nothing but an evidence that he is the messenger of Allah. Otherwise, Allah is jealous. Allah doesn't allow anyone to just to come and lie. That's why you see those who oppose Allah, they will eventually get their share in the dunya. You'll find them dying in the worst way, or something horrible happens to them. And so what about a man lying against Allah all these years? And Allah didn't take revenge from him? Rather, Allah aided him and assisted him, subhanAllah. This is yani something that we could witness from our own lives. Now, inshallah, we will stop. We have made it to the statement, وَأَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَحْدَهُ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ إِقْرَارًا بِهِ وَتَوْحِيدًا. This is the testimony of the Shaykh, رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ. InshaAllah, Azza wa Jalla, if Allah gives us the life and the endurance, then we will continue next week. Again, this is only in the beginning. This extensive explanation with the grammar and what have you is only in the beginning. InshaAllah, eventually, it will cool down. And you'll be able to relate more to what is being said, inshallah. And I remind myself and you to fast tomorrow, inshallah, in case that you were not, because I know they have problems with the tariq, with the date. Some say it's the 8th Muharram, 9th Muharram, what have you. The truth is, today is the 9th of Muharram, and which was advised that we have fasted today. And tomorrow is the 10th, inshallah, which is Jumu'ah. Now, usually it is not okay to single out Jumu'ah in fasting. But they say because of the day of Ashura, this is an excuse. This is Sheikh, I think it was Ibn Baz, rahimahullah. There's no harm in singling out this particular day in fasting. No, actually, he didn't mention this with Jum'ah. The Sunnah is that you fast 2 days. Remember, as we said in the khutbah, in order to distinguish ourselves from the disbelievers. You probably want to fast Friday and Saturday. Although some of the scholars say you shouldn't fast on Saturday because of a hadith, but I'm not going to take you there right now. But at least fast tomorrow, inshallah. Inshallah will be the sins forgiven for the past year. And Allah Ta'ala alam, alhamdulillah, wa sallallahu sallam ala nabiyyin Muhammad wa ala alihi sahbihi ajma'in.
What's the difference between Prophet and Messenger?
The difference between Prophet and Messenger is the Prophet is a Nabi, and the Messenger is a Rasul. A Nabi is the one who receives revelation from Allah, but is not given a new Sharia, not given a new legislation. Whereas the Messenger is a prophet, he has to be a prophet first, who receives revelation from Allah, and he's given a new Sharia, and he's commanded to convey to the people. See, like the children of Israel, they had many prophets that came ruling by the Torah. They were ruling according to the Torah. No new legislation was given to them. So they all considered prophets. Once you're given a new religion, new act of worship, new ways of doing things, then you become a messenger. And this is the